Good evening, everybody. Thank you all for staying. And for those who provided food, thank you for a very good meal. It was wonderful. Thank you for doing that, as always. This afternoon, I want us to continue what we started with this morning, which was a look at worship. This is our fifth Sunday. Out of the past fifth Sundays, we spent time talking about giving. We talked about singing. We talked about prayer. We talked about the Lord's Supper and various other things having to do with our specific acts, the things that we do when we worship. But right now, we're talking about our worship itself. And we noticed, obviously, you were all here this morning, the three D's that we're supposed to have around us as we worship. But now I want us to talk about ourselves before we worship. I understand it is hard, especially as a parent with two boys and having to witness my wife struggle with them as I'm getting ready, you know, to come here and do this. She's doing the things she's supposed to do as a mother. And I know it is hard, and it's, as fathers, it's also hard. And it's just as individuals forget to take the children out of the equation, it's hard sometimes to get ourselves up here right and ready. And sometimes we just come in, we sit down, and we just hope that we're in the zone enough that when the singing starts, we can actually mean it. And when the prayer is going on, we're actually praying. When the preaching is going on, we're actually following along and learning. And it's hard sometimes to get this up here ready to go, you know, get in that zone. And so if we can maybe consider some things that we should think about, that we can just dwell on, meditate on, if you will, to help our minds and help our minds to be prepared so that when we worship, we know that we're actually worshiping and we're not just going through the motions sometimes inadvertently. And so that's what I want us to consider. And it's this morning we have three D's. We have four P's this afternoon. I want us to consider four things. And really, if you want to put a title on it, the title I wrote in the pew bulletin is just four things to think about before we worship. If you want to get a more creative title, I guess it would be a mind made to worship, because that's what we have. We were made in the image of God. We were made to serve God. We were made to worship God for other purposes as well. But primarily, at least one of the major reasons He put us on this earth is to worship Him. Solomon says, fear God. That involves our reverence toward Him. And keep His commandments. That's how we do that. This is the first of man. This is the primary function of a human being. So how do we do that? What can we do up here to get ourselves ready to go when it's time to worship? Let's focus on, first of all, peace. Have our minds to be dwelling on peace. First of all, peace between us and God. Open your Bibles, please, to Isaiah chapter 26. Really a bit of 25 and a bit of 26. In Isaiah 25, if you're turning there, I'll show you. Let me open my Bible there. He makes the statement. Now remember, Isaiah writes to Judah as they are about to go into captivity. He writes to a people who are kind of in denial about the sin that they've committed against God. Now the prophet has to say, you're in it. Not you might get in it, but you are currently in it. And if you don't get out of it, you're going into captivity. But they don't seem to want to listen. And so he writes, look at verse 3 of Isaiah 25. My Bible says, therefore shall the strong people glorify thee, the city of the terrible nations shall fear thee, speaking about God. What it means is, when things are good, the strong, the boastful, the loud ones, when things are good, will say, oh, look at what God has done. When things are bad, they turn weak, they shrivel up, and they immediately start blaming God. Well, their relationship with God then is not as it should be. If you go to the next chapter, look at verse 20, or chapter 26, look at verse 3 and 4. Now, well, in fact, let's just read 1 through 4. Isaiah 26, in that day shall this song be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. Salvation will God appoint for walls and for bulwarks. Open ye the gates of the righteous nation, which keeps the truth, may enter in. We're going into a bad place, but we won't stay there. That thou wilt, verse 3, thou wilt keep him, that is the citizen, in perfect peace. I think that's a song we sing, isn't it? Peace, peace, perfect peace. Perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, who puts his mind on God, who keeps his mind on God, and that stays his mind. It means he calms his mind. Perfect peace. Mind is stayed on thee because he trusts in thee. Trust ye in the Lord forever, for in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. When we talk about peace, we don't mean the absence of war. Israel and Judah are going to have wars. What they mean, what he means is the calmness, the tranquility that comes, inner peace that comes by being one with God. When we worship, we're supposed to be one with God. So before we worship, put our minds on things of peace between us and God. Put your minds on things of peace between you and your brother and sister. Matthew chapter 5, we studied this morning. If you and your brother have an argument, if you have a disagreement, You need to reconcile with your brother before you can worship God. Oh, sure, you can offer the worship, but it's not going to be good worship. It's not going to be proper worship because your mind is not on worship. Your mind is on the brother with whom you have beef. But the reason he says that, if you're in Matthew 5, just jump back a couple of verses. Look at verse 21 and 22. You have heard it said before. This is what your law teaches. Don't kill. But if you kill, then you'll be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you, if you are even just angry with your brother, then you have already killed him in your heart. He says the same thing about adultery. If you just lust upon a woman, you wouldn't have adultery in your heart. He's teaching them about the relationship we have, or not just about what we do physically, but also about what we think internally. Well, here he says, after that he goes into, if you have aught with your brother. You see, it doesn't matter. I don't have to go punch my brother in the nose for us to have a disagreement. It could be something that's totally nonverbal. It could be something that's totally just thought. He's done something. I don't like it. Now there's an issue there. I have to resolve that issue. I have to find peace with my brother, or my worship will not be appropriate. My worship will not be proper. Peace. And lastly, peace with ourselves. You can read Psalm 31. Go home and read that. We're not going to read it. It's about 25 verses. I don't want to just stop just to read a whole psalm. But go home and read Psalm 31, and you can break this psalm down into three parts. It starts with David crying for peace. In the middle of it is David recognizing peace that comes from God, and at the end of it is David then inviting others to have that peace. So you have an exasperating, oh, I wish I had peace. You have an explaining, now I have peace. And then you have an exclaiming, you can have peace too. But it starts first with you having peace with yourself. You reconciling with yourself the things that keep you from God. You'd be surprised at the number of people who, if you told them, you have to do this and this to become a Christian. This is what you're lacking. Like Jesus told the man, go and sell what you have, that's what you're lacking. There's a lot of people who are ready to become Christians. They're just lacking one or two things, and you tell them those things. They know those things, they understand those things, but they refuse to do those things. Why? Because they can't get over this themselves. Their issue with God, they can't get over. Get over it. Whatever is you holding you back from God, set it aside. That weight that's holding you down, and find peace with yourself so you can find peace with God. We need peace. And when we go to worship God, let's let our minds be focused on peace. Number two, put your minds on power. For example, God's inherent power. That is, God, because He is God, is a powerful being, more powerful than us. Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. God says to His people, His arrogant, stubborn, set in their ways, blasphemous at the face of it, people. My ways, God says, are not your ways. He doesn't just mean because you're sinners and I'm not. He means me, who I am as God, is not like you. I made you. I made you in my image, but we are very different beings. My ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts. As far as the heavens is of the earth, so are my ways from your ways. But if you go back a couple of verses, Isaiah begs his people to seek the Lord, Isaiah 55, 6. So even though we are fundamentally different, even though He is not me and I am not Him, I am still told to seek after Him. How do I do that? Isaiah 55, 7. Forsake the wickedness of my ways, and let the unrighteous forsake his thoughts. But this appear in mind of God. And when I reflect on the great power that God has, bigger than me, different than me, it should motivate me to want to worship Him as He asked me to. Think about God's creative power. Genesis 1. Have you ever thought about how your Bible begins? Moses does not start the Bible by talking to you about how he knows there's a God. Let me prove it to you. A, B, C, D. Here's all the ways you can know there's a God. He doesn't do that. Your Bible never does that. The closest it gets is Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God. You can't look outside and not know there's a creator. But that's all you get. Moses does not start your Bible with, here's how I know there's a God. He just starts with God. In the beginning, God. And he takes it as an understood fact, because it is an understood fact. It's a relatively new thinking. Listen, it's a relatively new thinking that there is no such thing as God. Up until recently, people were not so ignorant as to think there wasn't something bigger than them. What that something was, people disagreed on. But everybody always understood the obvious fact that there's a God. And so he opens with that. Where did I come from? When I realize that I am made in the image of God, created by the Creator, then my motivation should be, He deserves my worship. I should want to worship Him. So put your thoughts on His creative power. And also put your thoughts on His redemptive power. He who made me. He who made everything. saved me from my sins, and that should make me want to serve him. Titus 2:11 through 14. The grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that by denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly and righteously in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all of our iniquity or sin, and purify to himself a peculiar people, different, zealous of the good works. We have been redeemed by God's grace. Redeemed, we sing how we love to proclaim it. Well, if we put it up here, then it'll help us as we worship him. So think about his power. Number 3 out of 4, think about purity. We've got, think about it like this, pure soul. We have, if you're a Christian, a pure soul. We didn't always have a pure soul. And I don't want to go too deep into it because we're all tired. We want to go home, but I want to give you just the gist of it. You do not always have a pure soul. You started out with a pure soul, but then we individually made the mistake and we blackened our soul. We made our souls impure. But through him, we can once again be pure and we can have a pure soul. That means a saved soul. You can worship God and not be a Christian, but your worship is unacceptable. Now, he won't strike you dead like he struck down the Old Testament priests who did wrong worship, but you will one day face judgment, and the end result is the same. The wind is what's different. He wants our worship to be pure. That means our souls have to be pure. That means we have to be saved. How do we be saved? Romans chapter 6. Reenact the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and your soul will be pure. That means having a pure mind. Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. We're priests, right? What's my sacrifice? Me. Present your body a living sacrifice, not a dead offering, a living one, holy and acceptable unto God. If you do that, you've done what you're supposed to do. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed. How? By the renewing of this. What are you thinking about? Renew this. Change this. Make it different. The renewing of your mind. That you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. What am I supposed to sacrifice? Myself. Am I the sacrifice that I, the priest, am supposed to offer? Am I a pure sacrifice? How do I do that? By being holy. Peter says, as obedient children, we should not fashion ourselves. He means don't dress like, but not in the literal sense. Just don't act like the former lusts and our ignorance that we once had. Don't act like the world. Be transformed. That means having a pure life. Colossians 3. If you then be risen with Christ, you become a Christian. Romans chapter 6. You reenact the death, burial, and resurrection. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Get your mind out of the gutter, literally. You're not thinking down here anymore. Think up there. Why? Because that's where Christ sits, at the right hand of God. And so set your affections. Set everything you think about on things above and not on things of the earth. Why, Paul? Because you are dead and your life is in with Christ and God. You died and came up a brand new being. So what do you think about when you worship? Think about how pure you are. Think about the power that God has. Think about the peace that you have with God. Lastly, think about perpetuity, which is just a P word for eternity. Think about eternity. Perpetuity, eternity to worship. Listen, if you don't like worshiping God, if you think it's a bore, if you think it's a chore, if you think it's a drag, that you have to get up and worship God every single Sunday, well, listen, you're not going to like heaven too much because you're going to be doing it every single, there is no end of it. You'll just keep on doing it. It'll never stop. You'll always be worshiping. So if you say, but I don't much like singing, well, you're going to hate heaven. Well, you know, I really don't care about praying. Well, God's going to be there for you to talk to him nonstop. Well, I don't know how much I like the word. They're going to read it. You better learn to like it or you're going to miss it. And you don't want to miss it. Revelation 19:1, John says, after these things I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, hallelujah, salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord of God. Where did he hear those things? In heaven. I don't want to talk about the context. The point is, in heaven, he heard them worshiping God. You're going to do it when you get there. The word hallelujah just means praise ye Jehovah. Just like the kids singing in VBS, hallelujah, 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 praise ye the Lord. That's what it is. You're going to be doing it for all eternity. So learn to like it now, because you'll love it then. Revelation 19:7, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor, worship to him. Eternity. In worship, eternity with loved ones. Second, and there's 1,000 verses I could give you. Let me give you just one. 2 Corinthians 4:14. Paul, as he's talking about going to heaven, and he says, all then shall be present in heaven, us with you. In other words, I'm going to heaven, Paul says, and I'll see you there. Will I see you there? I hope I'll see you there, but if I see you there, then I'll see you there. It's a hopeful kind of statement. He just throws it out there at the end of what he's talking about. We'll be there, us with you. Eternity. My sister Sarah, every single Christmas, without fail, she cries. I love Christmas. It's my favorite holiday. We play Christmas music on Halloween when I'm driving the kids to go trick-or-treating. We put our tree up November 1st. Okay, that's how crazy I am. I listen to Bing Crosby all year. My sister Sarah loves Christmas, but she weeps like a baby every end of Christmas because the whole family gets together and then we have to separate and then she just cries and cries. And we say, Sarah, why are you crying? Because I don't want it to be over, she says. She wants everybody to stay together. Well, listen, heaven is a family reunion, the good kind, that never ends. You'll always be there with your family. There'll never be any dispersing. There'll never be any leaving. There'll never be any see you next time. Because you're there, eternally with loved ones, perpetuity, last one, eternity with God. 1 Thessalonians 4:17, speaking of the resurrection, then us which are alive and remain will be caught up together with them, the them is those who died, they will also rise. We'll be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So we'll meet the Lord when he comes back, and we shall forever be with the Lord. Not till he gets tired of us, not till we're ready to go home, because there will be no, we'll be home. Will forever be with God, eternity with him. In heaven there is no Satan. In heaven there is no wickedness, there is no temptation, there is nothing sinful that could lead you into sin. It's just you, the faithful people of the past, the angels of heaven, and God your Savior. He is the focus of our worship. He is what is supposed to be on our minds. And so maybe this can help us put the things on our minds that will help us worship him better. Peace. Peace between us and God. Peace between us and our brethren. Peace with ourselves. Power, God's inherent power, his creative power, his redeeming power. Purity, that is having a pure soul, a pure mind, a pure life. And perpetuity in worship with our loved ones and with God forever and ever. If you're not a faithful Christian, be a faithful Christian. You start by becoming a Christian, by believing in Jesus Christ, by repenting to Jesus Christ, by confessing your faith in Jesus Christ, by being baptized into Jesus Christ, and then living faithfully with Jesus Christ. Jesus tells you to do all of those things. John 8, Luke 13, Matthew 10, Mark 16, and Revelation 2. You then become a faithful Christian. You walk with Jesus Christ. And then one day he'll come back and take you home to be with Jesus Christ forever and ever and ever again. If you're not doing that, if you're not ready for his return, get ready. Help us to help you right now as we stand and sing.